The views expressed on the following program are designed to amplify those of the speaker and are not necessarily those of KAAM, DJRD Broadcasting, or its sponsors.
Hello, everybody!
Here's what's coming up on today's experience. It's Dr. Dave's, that's right, doctor as in doctorate, Dr. Dave's devotional diamonds of the day, also known as DDDDDs, where my daily devotions become some of our spiritual reflections. Sound effects placed throughout the show which have nothing to do with life, but the Bible teaches there's a time to laugh, and some of you could use a good laugh. The review of the goofy news, which proves Jesus is coming back sooner than you think. Yes, that's what we should want. If you're a born-again, Bible-believing Christian, that's what we want. Life lessons for our faith that we could actually use, probably won't if we sit on our blessed assurance. Humor that will force you to think, why does this guy have a radio show? Because Noel had the day off and told me to leave the house, so I did. Also, Bible trivia for fake and yet somehow real cool prizes, your phone calls, and more. The David Spoon Experience, local, national, and heavenly talk. My name is Dr. David Spoon, and I will be your host for the next 5,400,000 milliseconds, which is a lot of them. Get ready for one of the more bizarre experiences on live radio. Here is the key to the show. We don't know what we're doing. Good night. Oh, no. We don't know what we're doing. We have no idea what's going to happen, and we don't care. But for the next few minutes, I want to talk truth with you. So here we go. We're asking questions about living life as a Christian. Here's another cool question. I like these cooler questions because, you know, sometimes they make you think. They kind of probe your brain a little bit. Listen to this one. Which of Jesus's miracles outside of the resurrection, okay, the resurrection, that would always be the top, but which of Jesus's miracles amazes you the most? Which of the miracles that Jesus did outside of the resurrections, which of those miracles are you just like, wow? There you go. That is your opportunity to think it through, to respond to it, to consider it, to wrap it around your brain. That means you're already meditating on the things of God, the very thing that God wants you to do. It's simple. If you have an opinion, a comment, a thought, or a question, you don't need it to let it die of loneliness. You can just reach out to us and give us a call. 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. And when you call 972-445-0770, well, by golly, you'll end up talking to Jammin' Jacob. Talking to Jammin' Jacob, man. Now, listen to this. That's like feeling confident that you have done your very best. Hey, hey, hey. Hello.
Thank you, David. Happy Wednesday.
Happy Wednesday to you, my friend. Happy, happy Wednesday. I do want people to be aware that you can reach out to us for a couple of different reasons. But first, let me tell you the ways to get in touch with us. Of course, there's the 972-445-0770. Then there is the opportunity for you to text us. So if you're in San Diego right now, it's 1134. If you're in Denver, it's 1234. Dallas, 134. Detroit, 234. And if you're anywhere else in the solar system off the planet, I cannot help you. Okay? But
if you're on the moon, you can shout very loudly, maybe we'll hear you.
Do you think they can get through? Do you think they can, if they're really loud, like me, like loud. Do you think they can get through?
I mean, if you're on the moon right now, if you're listening, try it. Try to shout as loud as you can.
Give it a shot.
Maybe we'll hear you.
If you're on the moon and you're listening right now, give us a shout. Nope, didn't hear anything. Okay, anyway. All right, so you can text us at 214. If you've got a little bottle, put a little note in it and then float it down to the earth. Okay, you can text us 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Non-professional voice coming now.
214-210-8483. Wow.
Okay, you can do that as well. Additionally, you can send an email, david@hemustincrease.org, D-A-V-I-D, that's my name, David, at hemustincrease, all one, .org, because we're a nonprofit entity. Why, would you call us, text us, or send us an email? That simple. First, you can answer that question. Which of Jesus' miracles amazed you the most outside of the resurrection? That's number one. Number two, I got something really cool. You can call for a praise report. We just want to give a quick update on Susie's brother, who we prayed for, who had a heart attack. She said he's doing better. He went through a second surgery. They were able to put the stents in. So he is doing better. So we're going to praise the Lord for that, plus continue to pray for him. And so we feel that that's a reason for you to reach out and call in. Just make it as simple as possible. Listen to what I'm saying. If the Lord has done something in your life, the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Sharing that thing the Lord has done, what does that do? It reinforces it in your own life. It blesses other people because people become aware God is active. Sometimes in people's lives, they haven't seen or heard, or things haven't been happening, and it's good to know right next door there's happenings, and we're all a part of that. And so it can be reinforcing for the person sharing. It can be blessing other people's, but most importantly, it honors the Lord. And I've said this before, and I want to say it again. People think, well, I don't want to give a testimony that's not, you know, like the parting of the Red Sea. Hey, anything that God does to you, for you, or with you is a miracle worthy of sharing. Because God only does the things he does having your best interest in mind. It's only the enemy that tells you otherwise. And there's too many people listening to that. Stop that. And so you can share a praise report. You can share a prayer request. What? Yeah, that's one thing we do. We pray for people. Why? Because it works. I've been doing this, it's, you know, 45 plus years in Christianity. You know what I found out? Prayer works. Does every prayer get answered? Nope. In fact, the ones that do get answered rarely get answered the way that I bring them up to the Lord. But they get answered. And here's the key in that. It doesn't mean you stop praying. It doesn't mean you stop witnessing if everybody doesn't get saved. It doesn't mean you stop praying for healing if everybody doesn't get healed. You keep going. You persevere. You keep pushing. You keep pushing. You keep pushing. You're going to find out a lot about that in the second 60 minutes of this show. But it can be for praise work. It could be something you just want to share. Maybe just something on your heart. The Lord's really touched you. You just want to share it and have an opportunity to do so. We want you to have that. So it can be for prayer, it can be for a praise report, it can be something you want to share, it can be any of that. Here's the key to our show, the goal. We're trying to encourage one another as we see the day of the return of Jesus Christ getting closer and closer, Hebrews 10:25. There's a lot of other excellent shows on this station and on other stations. And they do a phenomenal job of encouraging for the kingdom and teaching and guiding. And we love that. On our little space, in our little area, our goal is to be really focused on encouraging one another just to grow in the Lord, to become more like Jesus, and to touch other people with that same attitude and spirit. That's what we're doing. And we know it's not for everybody all the time, but everybody needs a little bit, and we're the little bit. And that's kind of how we look at it, okay? So we're just blessed by it because the Lord always blesses us in it. So if you got something you want to reach out, do it. Don't hesitate. In the meantime, I'm not going to wait for you today because, oh, boy, guess what we're doing? We're closing down or finishing up, either way you want to say that, Psalm 51, of course, one of the greatest psalms ever written. I think most people could recognize that. Bottom line in this process is we are picking it up basically in Psalm chapter 51, and we're picking it up at verse 16, and we will probably do 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. This will be the last closeout for 51. Listen to what it says right off the bat. This is what David's saying. Remember, this is after Bathsheba, big mistake, where he has Uriah the Hittite killed. He's already asked God to give grace. Please don't take your presence from me. I know I've blown it. I know I've done wrong. I know I said the wrong things. I know I thought the wrong things. And I know I did the wrong things. Please don't abandon me. I deserve to be abandoned, but please don't do it. Please just be merciful, graceful, kind in all of these situations. Please, please, please. I mean, that's what the psalm is. Also known, by the way, as the sinner's psalm, which still, it's a good psalm for that. There's nothing wrong with that. Here's what he says in verse 16. For you do not desire, you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offerings. What? The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Can't you just feel that you could preach on this for hours? For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I'd give it. I'd give it to you. You do not delight in burnt offerings. What's he talking about? When he's saying you don't desire sacrifice, or I would give it, you don't desire burnt offerings, it's the whole premise is, look, it's about true repentance versus sacrificial or ceremonial behavior. Did you hear that? It's about genuine repentance versus sacrificial or ceremonial behavior. God is looking for a deep, true, sincere, if you're going to lie about it, he already knows. He's looking for that genuine heart turn towards him. I was sharing with my next door neighbor. I only get, you know, when I share with people, I get a whole bunch in a very short amount of time. And when I was sharing with him my testimony about my deliverance from drugs, I told him, I said, it was the most honest prayer I think I've ever prayed in my life. Even to this day, I told him, because a part of me thinks that was just the most honest moment of my existence. When I told the Lord, I like doing this bad thing that you don't like me doing. So if I'm going to get away from it, you're going to have to help me. I can't do it without you. And how the Lord delivered me. I was just being honest. It's not that I'm great. In fact, the proof that I had to do that shows you that I'm not great and that I have a lot of problems in those the arenas of life and I have a lot of struggles. But that also shows the honesty with the Lord makes the difference. It changes everything. And if you're talking to God and you're, you know, when I unload, I know I'm the only Christian that unloads on the Lord. Anyway, when you're unloading, it's not like God doesn't know you're thinking it. But his love, his commitment, his steadfastness towards us is so solid. You're not going to say anything to God that's going to catch him by surprise. He knows every thought, every word, every action way before we do. And so David, he's writing, he's like, you know, if you really wanted sacrifices of lambs and this and that, whatever, and what he's talking about is their ceremonial sacrifice, not the sacrifice of Jesus, but he's talking about the actual ceremonial law sacrifices. And he's like, if you wanted that, I'd give it to you. But that's not what you want, Lord. You want it to be real. What David is saying is, I'm not going to give you this stuff that's just surface. I'm going to give you the real me. Here it is. I need help. And then if you look where he transitions into this, oh my, he transitions and he just says right from there in verse 17, he says, you do not desire sacrifice, or so I'd give it. You do not delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifice of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. What? Well, no, I just want to take this turtle dove and put it on the fire and be done with it. That's not how it works. And you cannot miss verse 17. I'm just not going to let you. This is foundational for most of us, if not all of us, to actually do this one thing, to become mature. What God is looking for when he's talking about a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart is a person before God that is broken so God can put you back together and mold you the way he wants to. The reason that we come before the Lord and we lay it out before him and just go, here it is. I got nothing. I have nothing. I am nothing. I own nothing. I understand nothing. Please, you are the potter. I am the clay. Please, build me the way you want me to be. And what God wants to do in all of our lives who are Christians is help us reflect Jesus more and more. And in doing that, it means that we need to be moldable. And to be moldable, we need to be broken so he can take the pieces and put them back together. And he doesn't want us to be religiosity. He doesn't want us to be doing churchianity. He wants us to be fully engaged with him in a relationship position where we say, Dad, you know best. Help me. Put me together. Put me together the way that I need to be put together. And when people go, well, you don't pray that because God will really do it. That's immature to say don't do that. That means that person doesn't really want to be like Jesus. And we can't afford to be that kind of Christian. That's more of an American Christianity than a genuine biblical Christianity. Can't do that. We need our actions to be deeply sincere and not ceremonial. And the things that we offer up in ceremony, they will have actually, if we do it in a sincerity first, when we do offer anything ceremonial, it will be much more valuable because it will be much more real. But the reality check in David's text is that what must come first from all of these things is an absolutely truthful heart. Did you do wrong? Own it. Did you ask for forgiveness? You've been forgiven. Are you keeping it? Well, then you're really being disobedient to God, because if he heard you, received it, and has given you grace and mercy, and you're still holding on to it, you're the idiot. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. You're the big idiot. That's what I wanted to say. Because if God has given you the grace and he's given you the forgiveness, why are you arguing with him? And so here's David. Now, what do we know from this text, and what do we know from this whole situation? We know that David actually received, first, without a doubt, the eternal forgiveness, but he actually received a great deal of grace in this process because he owned it, and he brought it for the Lord, and he said, change me, mold me, make them the way you want me to be. I really messed up. I've done the worst possible thing. And he did, by the way. He had one of his soldiers who loved him executed. Assassinated. That's pretty deep. He did all that to cover up his sin, which a lot of people do. They do a lot of ridiculous things thinking that they're going to cover their sin when, of course, that's not even close. But here's what David's saying. He said, for you do not desire sacrifice, or else I'd give it. You do not delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifice of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. That's what God wants from us. Us. Of all the sacrifices that God is looking for, I want to just give a plug to Tommy Barnett back in the day. For all the things that God asks you to give him, the one thing he wants above all these other things that we come up with, he wants the fullness of your heart. He wants every ounce. He wants you. That's why Jesus died for you, so you can be with God, so that you can be connected, so you can be eternally merged. That's why. Okay? All right. Take a deep breath. Wow, Dave, did you even breathe through that? Not that much. Okay, here we go. We're getting ready for our first trivia question coming up right now. Let's see if you guys can get this. When offered the people a choice, when he offered the people a choice. And the person offered, it was Barabbas or Jesus to be released. Who made this offer to the people? Who offered the people a choice? Barabbas or Jesus to be released? Who was it who did that? Matthew 27:17 is your answer for a biblical reference. Who offered the people a choice? This person said, Barabbas or Jesus? To be released. who offered that to the people. So listen to what I'm saying. I want to make sure you get this right. I want to make sure we're on par. Somebody said to the people, who do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus? Who made that offer? Get that? Okay. If you think you know, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or you can send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. Your reference point, Matthew chapter 27, verse 17. I'm going to send you up to the website. Why? Because I need to. That's why. So we know somebody's getting ready to answer trivia questions, so you better jump on if you have an answer for it. But here's, let me tell you this, on the website. On the website. So there is the new book. So there's five books up there. If you go on the website and you want any of the five and you can't afford it, we will buy it for you, period, and send it to you. And there's no obligation. If there's anything else you want that you come across on the website, tell us. We'll do our best to provide it for you. There's encouragement. There's video. There's audio. There's access to 4,500 hours worth of podcasts. There's all the shows that you've heard are on there somewhere. Sometimes I got to dig to find them. Plus, there's a place to give, and giving is good, because without that, what does the show sound like? Ready? That's what the show sounds like with no giving. Our scripture for today, Luke 6:38, given it will be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap, for with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And that's from God. Here it is in a nutshell. Check it out on the website, hemusincrease.org.
Prayer request?
hemusincrease.org.
Praise report?
hemusincrease.org.
Looking to give to this ministry?
hemusincrease.org.
Confused by what's happening right now?
hemusincrease.org.
hemusincrease.org.
What's the matter, Colonel Sanders? Chicken?
I'm so glad I found my Mel Brooks movies. That's all I can say. All right, somebody is ready to answer a trivia question. Let's send them on through. Knock, knock. This is David. Who am I talking to?
Hi, David. This is Deborah.
Hi, Deborah. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Good. Your voice sounds like really clear and stuff. Did you get a new phone? It sounds really, really good. I'm just saying.
Actually, yes, I did.
Ha! Wow, that's amazing. I still have hearing. That's good. Okay.
Hey.
All right, let me set it up for you, and then you can knock it out of the park for me. Here we go. Who stood before the people and offered the people a choice, not the people's choice award, but the people a choice, Barabbas or Jesus, he said, to be released. Who said that to the people?
Was it Pilate?
That is correct, Amundo! You are right. It was Pilate, the only person we know that flew a plane. Oh, wait, that's not Pilate. All right, so anyway, just double check on that. Excellent job. How are you doing, Deborah? How are you feeling?
I'm doing good. You know, I moved out of the assisted living for 2 months, and then I moved back. So I'm back at the assisted living.
Okay.
I was wondering if you could say a prayer for my good friend Jesse that lives here. He needs healing in his legs and feet and some encouragement.
Let's do it. Let's pray right now. Let's do it together,
thank
okay?
You.
Let's pray. Father, we come before you right now, and we thank you for our sister Deborah. We love her, Lord. She's great, and we're glad that she's a part of this fellowship. We just think it's cool. And we just thank you for her diligence in you. She knows your word. She's pursuing you, and she blesses other people when she calls in. I just think that's super cool. And she has, Lord, a friend. Jesse's his name. And you know all about it. You know all the details. You know what's going on with his legs, with his feet, and every part that's going on. And he's having a hard time, Lord. And he needs a miracle. And in that miracle, Lord, we just passionately ask you for it to be from you, and that he knows it's from you, and that it becomes a testimony for you, that you would move by the power of your Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus Christ, and you would touch Jesse in his legs and in his feet. And he would know this is a happening that is beyond the norm and that it comes from the hand of God. And that would be a testimony, and he would testify to that. And, Lord, we're asking you this not because we're worthy, but because you're generous and awesome. And we ask you in the precious and powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, David, and I hope y'all have a really good day.
Thank you. God bless you.
God bless. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right. Phenomenal job. It's always nice to hear from Deborah. Love it. Okay, so we only got about 2 minutes left. If you think this isn't, wait till you see when we get to the next. I just want to say, wait till you see when we get to the next 60 minutes. Okay, I'm going to do verse 18 and 19. Not going to spend a ton of time on it, so we'll just kind of leave it there. But he says this in verse 18, do good in your good pleasure to Zion. Build the walls of Jerusalem. And then you should be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness. So the ultimate sacrifice of righteousness is what? Jesus Christ is the ultimate sacrifice of righteousness on our behalf. I do find it always funny. We don't do a ton of politics here, as you know, but in almost every reference in the Old Testament, one of the most important things about a city and about a country are the walls. And so when everybody was saying, walls, 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 walls are bad, walls are evil, walls are this, of course, the new heavens, in the new Jerusalem, there are walls. Every time there was a break in the wall in the Old Testament, it was seen as a blight or as a weakness for the people of Israel. Walls are not evil. You know what they are? They're walls. Okay, that's what they are. And I can tell you right now, in the neighborhood I live in, if there weren't fences between the neighbors, it would be a lot different. That's all I'm going to say, especially with our dog, it'd be a lot different. And the reason I just bring that up is because I just find people go off on these tangents like, all right, forget that. Here's the big thing to remember from this teaching, right? Be honest with God and yourself. There's nothing in you that's going to hide it away that he's not going to see. There's no element in you he does not know, not one. So come forthright before the Lord, recognizing that he's the one that wants to rebuild you. Do you get that? And he's really good at it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Of course. All right, we are going to take a short break, and then we're going to come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
Hey there, it's Amazing Jennifer, and I am helping out the David Spoon Experience. As you may know, I basically run the KAAM radio station.
Amazing!
And Dr. Dave is looking for a few good people to join and become representatives, ambassadors, and stewards of this here radio ministry. Now you may be thinking, well, I'd love to get involved, but I'm not very qualified for ministerial positions. Well, the truth is that because you are a child of our Heavenly Father, that you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you seek to live by the power of the Holy Spirit, you have all you need to be a part of this ministry. But Jennifer, don't I need to be perfect? No. Just go to hemustincrease.org. That's hemustincrease.org. Click on the three lines at the top right of the website, and then click on the Ambassadors Initiative link. Just fill out the form and we will reach out to you. But sorry, no parking tickets will be paid for you as an ambassador through this position. You are on your own with that.
The Christian faith is being attacked. 50 years ago, people would disagree with Christianity, but with a sense of respect. Those days are over. The rage, the flesh, the enemy, and the atmosphere of sin is growing and growing. Jesus said in Matthew 24, "The love of many will grow cold." And if it's not the end now, it's certainly a lot closer than it was yesterday. You may be from a Baptist background. David Spoon has that. You may have a Pentecostal background. He has that too. You may have a non-denominational background. Yep, he's got that as well. You may be from the Church of Christ, Presbyterian, Methodist, Church of God, or some other denomination. But if you're looking for a show that's Bible-based, Spirit-led, and a bit nutty, give David a listen for a while. If you like it, great. If not, no worries. The David Spoon Experience.
A big portion of being guided is asking, prayer, when you're praying with people. Fellowship amongst other people can lead you to guidance. It's happened on more than one occasion for me. Counsel is obviously very good, both spiritual and not necessarily biblical. Also, practical counsel is good. Circumstances often speak to us and give us guidance. Open doors,
or, for that fact, closed doors. We know his word gives us guidance. We know in 2 Corinthians 2:13 and 14, Paul said that he used peace of mind as an aspect of guidance. These are all the Holy Spirit leading and guiding us is, of course, the number one element for guidance is to be led by the Spirit, right? These are all hugely important.
The David Spoon Experience.